As we have seen before, integrals are helpful for determining the area beneath curves that lie on two-dimensional planes. But did you know that integrals can also be used to find the volumes of shapes in three-dimensional spaces? Let's say I was interested in finding the volume of an apple. One way I could do that is by cutting the apple into very thin slices, each one approximately 1 millimeter thick. Then I could find the area of each slice's cross-section, multiply each area by its 1 millimeter thickness to get an approximation of the volume of each slice, then add all the slices' approximate volumes together. Of course, this method would give me the volume of something more like this with choppy edges, but it works nicely as an approximation for the apple's volume. When finding the volume of a shape or object with calculus, it is helpful to think of slicing the shape into very thin slices and finding the area of each slice's cross-section. By using integration, though, we can think of each slice as being infinitely thin, so that the volume obtained is the true volume of the shape and not just a blocky approximation. In order to obtain the volume of a shape using integration, you'll need a formula for the shape's cross-sectional area in terms of one variable. Whichever variable the area function is in terms of, whether x, y, or z, that is the axis which the cross-sections will be perpendicular to. This area function will then be integrated in terms of that variable, and the bounds of the integral will be two starting and ending values for that same variable. For example, if we wanted to find the volume of this shape using integration, we may choose to cut cross-sections perpendicular to the z-axis. In this case, we would need to write a function of the cross-section's areas in terms of z, and then integrate that area between the bounds z equals negative 2 to z equals 2, since the shape begins and ends at those height boundaries. Let's find the volume of this shape now. The equation of this ellipsoid is 4x squared plus 4y squared plus z squared equals 4. Since we are going to cut slices perpendicular to the z-axis, we need to write a function of the cross-sectional area in terms of z. Notice that our slices perpendicular to the z-axis will be circular in shape. What do we know about the area of circles? We know that the area of a circle is equal to pi times the radius squared. Now we need a way of writing this in terms of the variable z. If we move z squared to the right-hand side of the ellipsoid equation, we'll get 4x squared plus 4y squared equals negative z squared plus 4. Now, recall that the equation of a circle with radius r is x squared plus y squared equals r squared. We can get something very similar by dividing both sides by 4. So if we do that, we'll get x squared plus y squared is equal to negative z squared plus 4 over 4. What we have now is still the equation of the ellipsoid, but now the right side of the equation is exclusively in terms of z. Additionally, since the left side equals x squared plus y squared, the right side is equivalent to r squared in the equation of a circle. In this case, the equation of the circles we are cutting from the ellipsoid. So r squared is equal to this value, negative z squared plus 4 over 4. And we can use this to write the area function in terms of z. So our area formula in terms of z is equal to pi r squared. And we know that r squared is equal to this, so we'll substitute that in and get pi times negative z squared plus 4 over 4. This function represents the area of the cross-section of the circular slices of the ellipsoid. Now that we have this function, we can build the definite integral to obtain the volume of the ellipsoid. So we'll take the integral of this function. So we'll have the integral, and we'll find where it's from in just a second, of pi times negative z squared plus 4 over 4 dz. Based on the graph, we know that the ellipsoid's lowest point is at z equals negative 2, and that its highest point is at z equals 2. If we didn't have the graph available to look at, though, we could solve for this by setting x and y equal to 0 in the equation of the ellipsoid. Let's input positive and negative 2 as the bounds of integration. So we'll put negative 2 down here and positive 2 up here. Now, since pi and the 4 in the denominator are both constants, we can move them outside the integral. So we'll have pi over 4 times the integral from negative 2 to 2 of negative z squared plus 4 dz. Then we can integrate this. So negative z squared integrates to negative 1/3 z cubed. So let's write that down. Pi over 4 times negative 1/3 z cubed. And 4 integrates to 4z, so plus 4z, and we'll evaluate from negative 2 to 2. Plugging in the bounds at negative 2 and positive 2, we'll get pi over 4 times negative 1/3 times 2 cubed plus 4 times 2 minus negative 1/3 times negative 2 cubed plus 4 times negative 2. Then we can simplify this a little bit. So we'll have pi over 4 times negative 8/3 plus 8 minus 8/3 minus 8. This equals pi over 4 times 16/3 minus negative 16/3. So this is equal to pi over 4 times 32/3. And this is equal to 8 pi over 3. Since we are describing volume, this solution would be in units cubed. Let's try another problem now. Madeline is using a 3D printer to create a shape which is 2 centimeters tall at all points and which has a footprint in the shape of the area between the curve y1 is equal to 1/2 x squared minus x plus 1/2 and the line y2 equals 3 on the domain x from 0 to 3 expressed in centimeters. What is the volume in centimeters cubed of this shape? This kind of problem can be tricky to understand if you don't have a visualization of the shape. So let's graph the area between the lines y1 and y2 on the domain x from 0 to 3. This area describes the footprint of Madeline's shape, meaning this is what the shape looks like if you look down at it from directly above. To illustrate what Madeline's shape looks like in 3 dimensions, we can draw this graph at a slant and add in the z-axis. Remember, the height of the shape, which is the measurement along the z-axis, equals 2 centimeters at all points. So the shape would look something like this. Now, since the lines y1 and y2 are written in terms of x, let's see if we can cut this shape into slices perpendicular to the x-axis. Such slices would look something like this. These slices are each in the shape of rectangles, and each rectangle has a height of 2 centimeters, since the shape has a fixed height. The width of each rectangle is equal to the distance between y1 and y2. Since y2 equals 3 is above the curve y1, this distance can be written as y2 minus y1. We can easily calculate the area of each rectangle by multiplying y2 minus y1 by 2. So our area in terms of x is going to be equal to 2 times y2 minus y1. Now, since we know that y2 is equal to 3 and y1 is equal to 1/2 x squared minus x plus 1/2, we can plug these functions in. So this will be 2 times 3 minus 1/2 x squared minus x plus 1/2. And we can simplify this further. So this will give us 2 times 3 minus 1/2 x squared plus x minus 1/2, which is equal to 2 times negative 1/2 x squared plus x plus 5/2, which is equal to negative x squared plus 2x plus 5. Now that we have a function for the cross-sectional area of each slice, we need to take its integral. What are the bounds for this integral? Since we have area in terms of x and we'll be integrating in terms of x, we need to check the bounds of the shape in terms of x. We are told in the problem statement that the domain for the shape is x from 0 to 3, so the bounds for the definite integral will be 0 and 3. So we'll integrate from 0 to 3, negative x squared plus 2x plus 5 dx. Taking this integral, we'll get negative 1/3 x cubed plus x squared plus 5x, and we'll evaluate from 0 to 3. Then, if we do that evaluation, we'll get negative 1/3 times 3 cubed plus 3 squared plus 5 times 3 minus negative 1/3 times 0 cubed plus 0 squared plus 5 times 0. If we plug all this into a calculator, this part will simplify to 15. And since each part of this is multiplied by 0, it just simplifies to 0, so we'll have 15 minus 0. So the volume of Madeline's shape is then equal to 15 minus 0, which equals 15. And our units is centimeters cubed. So our answer is 15 centimeters cubed. Let's work through one more example. Consider the area bounded between the curves x1 equals 1/4 y squared and x2 equals 1/4 y plus 3 between the bounds y equals 0 to y equals 3. A three-dimensional shape whose footprint is this area is shaped in such a way that its cross-section, when cut perpendicular to the y-axis, is an equilateral triangle whose base lies flat on the xy plane. Find the volume in units cubed of this shape. Hint, the area of an equilateral triangle is equal to the square root of 3 over 4 times the side length squared. Let's begin by drawing the area between x1 and x2 on the xy plane and then visualizing what the 3D shape looks like. x1 equals 1/4 y squared is shaped like a sideways parabola, while x2 equals 1/4 y plus 3 is an upward sloping straight line. The area between these curves from y equals 0 to y equals 3 is shaped somewhat like a shark fin. In terms of this shape's 3D appearance, we are told that its cross-section, when cut perpendicular to the y-axis, is an equilateral triangle whose base is on the xy plane. So we can draw the shape in this way. Now, we know that we are going to need to do an integral to find the volume of this shape. And before we can do the integral, we need a function of area in terms of one variable. In this case, since we know that the slices will be cut perpendicular to the y-axis, we are going to want the area of each cross-section written in terms of y. Remember, the area of an equilateral triangle equals the square root of 3 over 4 times the length of the side squared. We can find that side length by finding the distance between the two curves x1 and x2. Since x2 is farther to the right and therefore has greater x values, we will write this distance as x2 minus x1, or 1/4 y plus 3 minus 1/4 y squared. Writing this in descending order, the side length of each triangular slice equals negative 1/4 y squared plus 1/4 y plus 3. Now we can write the area function in terms of y as the area in terms of y is equal to the square root of 3 over 4 times negative 1/4 y squared plus 1/4 y plus 3 squared. The bounds of integration for this shape will be at y equals 0 and y equals 3 as mentioned in the problem statement. Let's write the definite integral now. So we'll have the integral from 0 to 3 of the square root of 3 over 4 times negative 1/4 y squared plus 1/4 y plus 3 squared dy. To make this integral easier for ourselves, let's move the constant, the square root of 3 over 4, in front of the integral and expand the squared expression inside. So we'll have the square root of 3 over 4 times the integral from 0 to 3 of 1 over 16 y to the 4th minus 1 over 16 y cubed minus 3/4 y squared minus 1 over 16 y cubed plus 1 over 16 y squared plus 3/4 y minus 3/4 y squared plus 3/4 y plus 9 dy. Now we're going to simplify our terms inside. So this will give us the square root of 3 over 4 times the integral from 0 to 3 of 1 over 16 y to the 4th. then we can combine negative 1 over 16 y cubed, negative 1 over 16 y cubed, and that will give us negative 1 over 8 y cubed. And then we can combine negative 3 fourths y squared, 1 16th y squared, and negative 3 fourths y squared. And we'll get negative 23 over 16 y squared. Then we'll combine 3 fourths y and 3 fourths y, and we'll get 6 fourths y, which is equal to 3 halves y plus 9 dy. Now we can take the integral and get the square root of 3 over 4 times 1 over 80 y to the 5th minus 1 over 32 y to the 4th minus 23 over 48 y cubed plus 3 fourths y squared plus 9y, and we'll evaluate from 0 to 3. Since each of these terms has a multiple of y, we know that evaluating at 0 will just give us 0. So we just need to evaluate at 3. So if we do that, we'll get the square root of 3 over 4 times 1 over 80 times 3 to the 5th minus 1 over 32 times 3 to the 4th minus 23 over 48 times 3 cubed plus 3 fourths times 3 squared plus 9 times 3. If we plug this into a calculator, we'll get approximately 9.23 cubic units. As we've seen, problems where you need to find volume with integration can be daunting at first glance. However, you should find it helpful to start by sketching what the shapes look like. Then decide which axis your slices will be perpendicular to and write an area function in terms of that variable. Finally, integrate this area function and evaluate it at the appropriate bounds to determine the shape's volume in cubic units. As always, this gets easier with practice, so I encourage you to try some example problems on your own now. Thanks for watching and happy studying.